Welcome to this webinar about follow-up of employees on sick leave. My name is Anna Sundstad, and I'm a lawyer in Thomsen's employment law team. And with me is my colleague Alexandra Refsnes, who works the same place. In this webinar, we will focus on the employer's obligations to follow up employees on sick leave.
And most employers will at some point experience having employees on sick leave. As a general rule, the overall goal is that the employee will be able to return to work. And in this regard, the employer has a number of statutory duties that is meant to contribute to and support the employee's return to work. The purpose of this webinar is to give you a practical introduction to how employers should follow up employees who are on sick leave. Here is an overview of the agenda for the webinar. In this webinar, we will provide an overview of the employer's role towards employees on sick leave. We will talk about the employer's duty to accommodate, the requirements for follow-up plans and dialogue meetings with the employees on sick leave. And lastly, we will talk about the rules for terminating the employment of employees who are on sick leave.
In this slide, we have included the parties responsible for an employee who is on sick leave. Before we take a closer look at the employer's obligations towards or relating to follow-up of employees on sick leave, it's worth mentioning that it is not only the employer or the company who has obligations towards an employee on sick leave. And in addition to the employer or the company, we have the employee on sick leave. We have the person who issues the sick leave certificate, which is typically a doctor. And we have the Norwegian Labour and Welfare Administration, also called NAV. And all of these actors will have statutory obligations in connection with an employee being on sick leave. Appropriate follow-up of an employee on sick leave will require cooperation between these parties that are involved. And as we will come back to later, the employer has mandatory obligations towards all of these actors.
In this webinar, we will focus on the employer's duties towards its employees. One of these duties is the so-called accommodation obligation. Pursuant to section 4.6, first paragraph of the Norwegian Working Environment Act, employers have a duty to make adaptations and accommodate for employees with reduced work capacity as a result of an accident, illness, or similar. The employer shall, as far as possible, take the necessary measures to enable the employee to retain the employee's current work or to be given other suitable work.
The accommodation obligation applies to any employee with reduced work capacity as a result of accident, illness, wear and tear, or similar. In other words, employees do not need to be on sick leave for the employer's accommodation duty to be relevant, but the accommodation duty naturally also applies to this group of employees. And the facilitation obligation becomes relevant when an employee with reduced work capacity has notified and documented the reduced work capacity. Documentation will typically consist of a medical certificate from a doctor. The employee must also, as far as possible, provide information on whether the reduced capacity to work is of temporary or permanent nature. For example, a bone fracture may typically result in temporary reduced work capacity, while chronic illness and major injuries may, depending on the circumstances, result in more permanent reduced work capacity.
The accommodation duty means that the employer is obliged, as far as possible, to take the necessary measures to enable the employee to retain his or her current work or to be given other suitable work. And both the employer and the employee can propose measures. Since it is the employee who knows his or her own limitations best, it is often practical that it is the employee who proposes suitable measures first and that the employer considers these. And some practical examples of accommodation measures are change or modification of tasks, adjustment of working hours, and change of work equipment. The question of whether the employer has fulfilled its duty to accommodate or not depends on an overall assessment taken into account, for example, the undertaking's nature, size, and finances, which must be assessed against the employee's circumstances. The assessment is based on whether it's economically and practically possible and justifiable to order the employer to implement the relevant accommodation measures. The accommodation obligation is far-reaching, partly because it's considered to be a key instrument for getting employees on sick leave back to work. This means that in principle, the employer must go to great lengths to accommodate for the employee. The duty is, however, not absolute. For example, the employer is not obliged to create a new position for the employee in question or to implement measures at the expense of other employees in the undertaking.
Now we'll talk, we will turn to talk a little bit about follow-up plans. If the employee is on sick leave, the employer will normally have an obligation, together with the employee being on sick leave, to prepare a plan for return to work. Such a plan is called a follow-up plan, and there is a number of requirements for both the preparation and content of such a plan. And we will give an introduction to these requirements now.
The employer shall, in collaboration with the employee on sick leave, prepare a follow-up plan for the return to work, unless this is considered clearly unnecessary. And there are two situations when the preparation of a follow-up plan might be unnecessary. One situation is when the employee wants to return to work quickly and can return to work quickly. For example, after a short sick leave due to influenza or a broken arm. Another situation, which is quite opposite, is when the medical condition is so severe that it can easily be established that the employee will not be able to return to work. With the exception of these two cases that I just mentioned, a follow-up plan must be made for all employees on sick leave, including employees with graduated sick leave. And the follow-up plan shall be made no later than when the employee has been completely or partially absent from work for 4 weeks and is normally completed through NAV's pages. The employer is responsible for ensuring that the person on sick leave and NAV become familiar with the follow-up plan. The employer must also send the follow-up plan to the person who issues the sick leave certificate, typically a doctor, as soon as it has been prepared and no later than 4 weeks into the sick leave. An updated follow-up plan must be sent to NAV no later than 1 week before the dialogue meetings. And we will talk about the dialogue meetings later in this webinar.
On this slide, we have listed some bullet points about what the follow-up plan should contain. And there is a number of requirements for what the plan should contain. And the purpose of making the follow-up plan is to find out what is needed for the employee to function at work. The requirements for the content of the follow-up plan have been set to ensure that the key prerequisites for such facilitation and return to work are discussed between the employee on sick leave and the employer, and potentially also other parties involved. The scope of a follow-up plan may vary depending on how the employee's ability to work is and the assumed duration of the reduced work capacity and the absence. The follow-up plan shall first and foremost include an assessment of the employee's work tasks and the ability to work. The employee's job duties and the employee's current ability to perform these tasks must be described. Furthermore, the follow-up plan must include relevant measures arranged by the employer and possible measures with assistance from the authorities. Further, the follow-up plan must also contain information about the plan for further follow-up of the employee.
It is also required by law to conduct collaborative meetings during the sick leave period, which are called dialogue meetings and which we will talk about now.
The topic of the dialogue meetings is the follow-up plan and how the parties can collaborate to get the employee back to work as soon as possible. And when the first dialogue meeting should be held depends on whether the employee is completely or partially out of work. If the employee is completely out of work, the first dialogue meeting must be held within 7 weeks, unless it is considered clearly unnecessary. If the employee has been partially out of work, a dialogue meeting shall be held with the employee, employer, or the person who issues the sick leave certificate when that person deems it appropriate.
And it's the employer's responsibility to summon the employee to the first dialogue meeting. The person who issues the sick leave certificates and other actors, such as the Occupational Health Service or NAV, can participate at the request of the employee or the employer. It is worth noting that employees may object to the doctor's attendance in the dialogue meeting.
At the latest, when the employee has been out of work for 26 weeks, meaning 6 months, a new dialogue meeting shall be held. The employee, employer, the person who issues the sick leave certificate, or the Norwegian Labour Welfare Administration, NAV, may, however, require that dialogue meeting number two is held at an earlier date.
And while it is the employer who is responsible for arranging dialogue meeting one, it is NAV that summons the employer and employee for dialogue meeting two. The person who issues the sick leave certificate or other health personnel can also participate in this meeting. And the person who issues the sick leave certificate is obliged to attend this dialogue meeting if it is required by NAV. Dialogue meeting two will be a follow-up to dialogue meeting one, and the purpose is for the parties and NAV to meet for a joint review of the situation. The topic of the meeting will essentially be the same as in the first dialogue meeting. And in brief, this entails reviewing and updating the follow-up plan, assessing any measures, and clarifying which work tasks the employee can perform.
The employee, the employer, the person who issues the sick leave certificate, or the Labour and Welfare Administration, NAV, may request that a new dialogue meeting shall be held between the employee on sick leave and the employer. Such a third dialogue meeting is held before the sick leave has lasted for a year. For dialogue meeting number three, the same starting points apply as for dialogue meeting number two. In other words, it is NAV who summons the meeting, and the person who issues the sick leave certificate can be ordered to attend.
In this slide, we have made a timeline to show important dates that the employer must adhere to with regards to the follow-up plan and dialogue meetings. And to summarize, the follow-up plan shall be made as soon as possible and no later than when the employee has been completely or partially absent from work for 4 weeks. And within 7 weeks after the employee has been completely absent from work, the employee must have employer must have arranged and held dialogue meeting one. No later than when the employee has been on sick leave for 26 weeks, NAV must call for a second dialogue meeting, and if the employee, employer, the doctor or NAV so requires, a dialogue meeting three must be arranged, normally within 52 weeks.
It is important that the employer remembers to document the follow-up of the employee on sick leave. And the employer should save all versions of the follow-up plan, write minutes from dialogue meetings, and save other correspondence with the employee and other actors involved in the process. And ensuring good documentation of the follow-up of employees on sick leave is important if the company later wishes to terminate an employee on sick leave.
And in continuation of the employer's obligation to follow up employees who are on sick leave, it is also relevant to say something about termination of employees on sick leave. Employees on sick leave have a special protection against termination pursuant to Section 15(8) of the Working Environment Act. This protection against termination applies regardless of whether the employee is on full or partial sick leave, and regardless of the reason for the sick leave. The special protection against termination means that employees on sick leave cannot be terminated because of the sick leave during the first 12 months after the incapacity to work occurred. It should be mentioned that only terminations that are due to the sick leave as such are prohibited. This means that employees on sick leave are not protected, for example, in the case of redundancies. However, if an employee on sick leave is terminated during the 12-month protection period, the employer will have the burden of proving that the sick leave has not affected the decision to terminate the employee. This means that the employer must prove that the termination was based on other circumstances than the sick leave. And there are strict requirements for evidence in such cases, and the protection against termination also applies where the termination is implicitly based on the sick leave.
After expiry of the 12-month protection period, the employer may terminate the employment due to the employee's sick leave, provided that there are justifiable grounds for termination. And whether a termination based on the employee's illness or sick leave is justifiable will depend on an overall assessment, and the threshold for termination due to sick leave is high. And whether the employer has fulfilled its duty to accommodate and make adaptations for the employee, the length of the sick leave, and whether the medical picture has been sufficiently clarified, the employee's prospect of returning to work within reasonable time, and the disadvantage that the sick leave represents for the employer are all relevant factors in this assessment. The employer's duty to accommodate entails that a termination of employment will normally only be regarded as reasonable and justified if it is not possible to implement accommodation measures which will enable the employee to return to work, and that it is not possible to relocate the employee to another position in the company with tasks that the employee can be able to perform. However, note that the employer is not obligated to make or create a new position specifically for such an employee.
If the employee will be able to return to work within a short time period, a termination due to the sick leave will normally be invalid. Further, the employer should be able to point out specific disadvantages of the employee's sick leave. For example, that other employees in the company have to carry out the tasks of the employee while he or she is on sick leave, making the employee's absence burdensome for the other employees. And another disadvantage could be that it's difficult to find a suitable temporary replacement for the employee.
We thank you for your attention, and we hope that this webinar has provided a practical introduction on how to follow up employees on sick leave. If you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to us with the contact information on the slide.